Nityanandam, and welcome back to your viewers. We just heard a very beautiful sharing from Nitya Parameshwarananda, who shared with all of us how, as a mother, and as she was a single mother and everything, how her passing, she was able to be healed of the passing of her husband just by Devi Parashakti's one boon. Next, we have one person who's joined to share with us, who has a very unique, a very powerful, and a very exciting sharing in store, who is going to be sharing with us about how her lifestyle was, how was her lifestyle, her upbringing, her ambience, and everything, and how meeting Swamiji and how understanding about Hinduism has drastically empowered her, changed her, made her realize that her dreams are not just dreams, that can simply become reality. We have joining with us Ma Nitya Jnaneshananda. Nityanandam,
thank you so much for having me. So my name is Ma Nitya Jnaneshananda. I do live in New York City, Brooklyn, New York. I found Swamiji, or he found me, back in 2017, during the world tour, actually. And it was kind of crazy, because I was going to move to California, and I moved back to New York, and I'm an entertainer, and things just weren't working. Things just weren't going my way. And I was asking God, and I was praying to God for just a new lesson. And I was Christian at the time. And when I noticed, it came to me one day, every time that I would pray and ask God for a new lesson, there would be, like, I would get on Facebook and there would randomly be a picture of this Indian man going, and I really didn't know what that meant. And when I noticed that it was happening over and over again, and every time I asked God for a new lesson, I would see it, I decided to click on it. And it was talking about the world tour coming to New York City. And I said, okay, you know, I'll check it out. You know, it can't hurt to check out.
Your feed. So like, sorry, just to understand. So it kept coming, popping your feed again and again, the same photograph of Swamiji, whom you did not know at that time. And it just kept coming, coming again and again. The divine intervention.
Yeah, just I didn't know why this man was just like that. This picture of this smiling man. And I've got to let you know that I did not really have any Hindu friends at that time. I think I had one or two Hindu friends, but I don't believe that they were devotees. And so I went to the world tour, and I had to fight for that day off because I worked that day, and my life was changed. It was really just powerful, because the things that they did were things that I felt that humans could do, but we didn't, you know, it's just something that you normally just see in a comic book, you know, to see, Maha Yoga, read people, heal people, to see Ma Yogananda walk around blindfolded, handing out roses. What people were like stopping her just randomly and showing, she was telling them what was in their wallets, their purses, their pockets, and then them pulling it out. And like, it was really exciting. And then, towards the middle, they were like, you can do it too. Hey, what? And they say, yeah. And then they pull out a coconut, and you had to get a partner. I was there by myself. Thankfully, the guy next to me was by himself, and we became partners. And I set the coconut on my hand, and he moved it. I didn't move at all. He moved it. And it was really exciting. And so then it was my turn, and I chanted the Mahabharata, which at that time was Om Nityananda Mahasadashivoham. And I kept doing it, kept chanting, kept looking at the coconut, telling the coconut to move. It started vibrating, then it shaked in his hand, and then it moved. It was like, oh, you know, and I realized that if I can do that, then I can do everything else that they said that they were doing, and they said that I could do it. And then later on in the evening, they were like, oh my gosh, we're so blessed. Swami Ji has made his appearance. But also, I want to say too, when I came, just as a, I'm an American, and I'm sure a lot of other Americans can relate. We have a tendency to be a little like, or especially New Yorkers, we can be a little like, we've been there, done that, seen everything. And so when they first appeared and the curtain went up, all those beautiful people were there except for Swami Ji. There was a cardboard cutout in the middle of Swami Ji, and the boys were on one side, the girls were on the other. And I was thinking, this is New York City. He couldn't come to New York. Like, what is going on? But I didn't really understand who he was. And then when they were like, oh my God, we're so blessed that he's carved out some time in his schedule for us. We were in a theater. And so then they brought the screen down and projected him. And when they projected his image on the screen, he looked and he said, New York City. I felt it. Like, I felt it internally. I felt that he was speaking to me. At that time, Robin Taylor, he was speaking to me. And I was like, this is it. This is what I've been waiting for. And immediately, like at that day, that was it. I no longer started going to church. I started going to temple. I didn't know where to start. I started ordering all the like Hindu books that I could. I got on all the mailing lists. And then thankfully I found the temple that was in the area. And the rest is history. I've been following them ever since.
Well, I just wanted to add one small thing, like when you're sharing. Like, just you were saying, right, that a typical American kind, a typical New Yorker kind thinking. And you were saying, I just remembered one small sharing from Swamiji. When Swamiji was landing in the U.S. for the first time ever, right? And that was when Swamiji had just started the mission. Swamiji had just started, and there were just it was a small group. It was a small mission at that time. Early years, early 2000s, when Swamiji first time went to the US. And Swamiji was there, a young boy. And, you know, just so new for the first time landing in US. He was just all by himself with just saffron dhoti and an angavastram. And Swamiji is there landing in the airport, entering the airport. And the airport officers look at him and ask, hey, you think you're going to be able to talk? People are going to, you know, listen to you or get, they're going to get anything from you with you, you know, seeing you in some saffron robes like this. And then they ask Swamiji that. And Swamiji says, give me 1 week. I will make this as a fashion in America. For a young man who's just entering the U.S., and this is what Swamiji said. And today, seeing you, a New Yorker, and sitting here with sari, rudraksha, jatas, and trinetra tilak, everything, that just shows how much of a depth, how much Swamiji just touches our being and transforms. It is so beautiful to listen to it from you. And how did you see the difference, Ma? You were saying you were going to churches and there was a different lifestyle that you were living. And when you decided that, you know what, I have to become a Hindu, it was so cool. And you so beautifully shared that how the people are all manifesting powers, just chanting Swamiji's name without knowing who Swamiji is, you were able to start manifesting those powers. How did this drastic lifestyle from believing that, you know, there are different, as a, you know, the, in your religion, in the previous religion that you were in and that upbringing and everything, the kind of cognitions that you might have had would have been entirely different from cognizing you are God, you are Paramashiva, you are the divine, and what Swamiji is what you are. How did that drastic change happen? You know, how did you meet it? How did that happen in you?
Oh man, it was such a change, because in my previous religion, we are taught that we are sinners from birth. There's an age of accountability, and like from the time that you are born up until like maybe 12, you're blameless. But once you reach the age of accountability, you are a sinner, have to repent for your sins, because this special person decided 2,000 years ago to die for you, and then and all of the things that goes with that. But Swamiji says that you are not a sinner. You know, you are not this evil being that you had nothing to do with. You know, that you are God, and your actions are what makes things happen. It's not some creature that's thinking about coming to get you. You know, that's doing these bad things to you. It's an accumulation of the things that you take in. If, like, I'm an actor, if I want to do a particular show and I didn't get the show, did I practice? Did I study? Did I go to the audition? Did I know my lines? Did I sing my song correctly? Those things are important. Or did I just lay around and then decide, okay, I'm going to get up and try to go to this audition? It doesn't work that way. If you're prepared and do the things, then things can happen. You know, if you don't, if you just sit around, you can't blame anyone for your action, for what's happened. It is your actions. And I can say, I had asked Swamiji for help and guidance with my career, especially right before I went to Bidity. And while I was in Bidity, I was like, when I go back, I really need some help with my career. I need some guidance. And I said, I want to only work in the entertainment industry. Because before, like a lot of other people in New York that are actors, I was serving tables and, you know, things of that nature. And when I came back, I booked TV shows. Then I started working in, I was working behind the scenes, but working in the Broadway field. And then when COVID happened, it was actually a blessing for me because I got to step back and take a break. I got to devote all my time to Swamiji and Paramahansa Bodham Level 2. And then when I was ready to get back into it, he blessed me with like some major things going on. So that was all through his grace. And it was all because I decided to get up and work towards it with his grace.
Wow. Just with Swamiji's blessings, you were able to manifest the career that you wanted. You were able to manifest jobs, just manifested for you, like you said, about how writing the TV show scripts or the Broadway shows, everything you were just being able to be part of. And one important thing that you shared, I'm sure, which every viewer will be able to relate with. There are so many people actually commenting that they're able to understand, they're able to experience Swamiji in each and every expression that you are sharing, like in each and every sentences that you are sharing. Because it is so true, Ma, from being taught that you are a sinner, and you are responsible, and that guilt being used, you know, there
to exploit.
And throughout continuously that guilt being used. And it's not like, it's not, unfortunately, it's not conscious. People continue to believe that guilt, which gets passed on generations after generations, generation after generation. And here you come, walk into a show, walk into a world tour, and walk into a group of people, and then listen, see Swamiji's picture and listen to him say, you are not a sinner, you are God. You have the infinite possibility to create life as you want. And there you are, just those words making a huge impact on you, and you're able to start manifesting powers. What, like you beautifully said, what you saw in comic books, what you would have heard in Harry Potter stories, here was a reality happening right in front of your eyes.
And not just someone else doing it, but showing that you can do and making you do it. Wow.
So tell me, Ma, how did you experience, how is it for you to see Devi Parashakti coming, manifesting, giving boons? And how did you experience it? Just yesterday, you received a beautiful blessing from Devi Parashakti. So how was it for you?
Oh my goodness. So it was really exciting and awe-inspiring. And I really think that it took some time to settle in after the fact, instead of just in that moment. I had wrote her, my grandmother has been very ill, and I have written a lot of people, anyone that's my friend on Facebook, I've written them on Facebook, I've written on WhatsApp, I've written you ladies, everyone, to please heal my grandmother. And so I asked Ma to heal her, and there was no response, and that's fine. I know she sees all. I asked her for a personal thing, and there was no response. That's fine. And so then a thought came to me, and I've been wondering about it. And so I thought, this is a good time to ask, you know. Ever since I was young, I've been sick when I was young. I had a childhood illness for quite a while. And while I was young, I would have a lot of these supernatural experiences, and I would tell people about it, and they really weren't very open to it. One of the things that I noticed, and I would tell people about, is that I could see other people's point of view from their perspective, meaning I could see as if I was seeing through their eyes, or I was sitting in their presence. So wherever you two ladies are, if I concentrated and I breathed enough, I could either see it'd be like a split second, for like a moment, out of your eyes, or I could, it would be as if I was sitting right next to you and seeing what you're seeing. And that would happen to me a lot. And it was also kind of I learned that it was a good mechanism that kind of kept me safe, because I was able to kind of know what was going on with the people around me, be it good or bad, especially in school. And, but people didn't really believe me. I think my mom and my father were like the only ones that would believe me. And so then I had remembered that, and I asked Ma Parashakti about that. I said, you know, as a child, I was able to see people's point of view through their eyes. I'm just wondering, when I learned that with Swamiji in a different life, in a previous life, and what the name of that Shakti is. And immediately she said, Ma Nitya Yaneshananda Tathastu, I will give you my powers, put your Atmalinga on your third eye. And then she told everyone in the world to do the same thing. And so then we all got blessed into that Shakti. And it was just really cool. And then when that first happened, I was just like, all right, cool. And then after it was over, I really thought about what happened. And I'm like, instead of just saying, oh, it's the Shakti and moving on, she was like, she just showered on all of us her powers, you know, her Shakti, and it, or I'm guessing that Shakti, or all of Shakti's, I don't know. It just, I realized that I was different, and I just remember just crying after it was over, just blissful tears.
Actually, Ma, you know what? Because in the whole world right now, there are many beings who are like how you were sharing, right? Because in your earlier religious belief, you were forced to believe that you were a sinner. And even when some powers, like some possibilities, some powers naturally were trying to express itself through you, you were embarrassed about it, because people were not ready to accept it. People are not ready to take that. And it might have caused you might even be bullied, because, you know, people do not feel that as normal. But when you saw that, when you were met Swamiji, when that divine intervention happened in your life, you saw how beautifully that very fundamental root cognition Swamiji shifted in you, saying, You are not a sinner. You are God, and you have infinite possibilities for you. And you can create whatever you want. And not just stopping that, making you manifest the powers. And see, there are many people. Actually, today, if you see in so many countries, the conflicts that are happening, the violence that is happening, so many people going through so much, people are in so much of chaos inside, which is reflecting outside. And when you keep believing that you are like, you know, some lower cognition about yourself, you put yourself down more and more. And because your being is not able to tolerate itself, because that is not it, but you force feed, you try to force feed the cognition and try to suppress it, it erupts more out as a violence. So when that violence is coming, that's why you can see today, so much is happening in the world, be it, I don't want to name the conflicts, but you know the amount of violence. People are afraid of their lives. People are trying to flee to a different place. They are not feeling safe in their own homes. This is the current scenario that is happening in the world today. But this is because the violence that is erupting out of people, which is reflecting outside as violence, which is reflecting outside as climate crisis. This inside what is there. But now the grace, blessings of Para Shakti, she has shifted that cognition in you, and not just shifted, but through, just because you asked for one boon, she could have just blessed, but she didn't stop with that. She showed you that, see, really, I am there for you as a cosmic mother. I am there for you. She has showered her love upon you in an unfathomable way. For one person's boon, just for one person, she initiated a whole world with that Shakti. My God, this is the compassion of the Cosmic Mother. Actually, because of that, when that initiation happens, when that Diksha happens, and that when power manifestation happens through us, we express that energy in the form of power manifestation, and all the violence in us, all the conflicts that in us will melt down, resulting in the world reflecting the same. It will add so much of healing for the whole world. Do you realize? For you, it was this one boon. You asked for a boon, and Cosmic Mother herself came down in physical form, blessed and made sure, not just blessing you, she gave that as a boon to the whole world. And not just that, but she healed the whole world through it. That is the compassion.
Ma, that's the thing. Like, I didn't ask for a boon in that regard. I just asked her what was the name. And instead of just answering me and going on, she decided to bless everyone. And that's the part that just blew my mind. Also, I wanted to express, because I did ask her to heal my grandmother. Right before we got on here, I called my uncle and asked an update. And she's been in the hospital for a while, and he said that they're going to discharge her today. So I just wanted to share, just in that level too, how Ma Parashakti is taking care. And also, I felt seen, because, you know, so many times, so many of us, we write when she comes to bless us and to give boons, we all write her, you know, and she doesn't respond verbally to every single person. But I have noticed every time that I write her and ask her something, even if she does not mention me, it gets resolved, you know, in one way or another. So I know
Devi had blessed this mom. Devi Parashakti had told that even if her eyes fall on your message, that's the reason we encourage people to post their messages. Even if her eyes fall on your message, it is blessed. That is why there are so many people, they just put a comment on the YouTube to Devi Parashakti, and their boons just manifest, even though Parashakti wouldn't have even uttered their names. Just her eyes falling on it is enough. Her eyes are so powerful. Just that power of her eye, immediately, that is why she's called as Kannatha. just her look is so powerful, and it's also, and you're so blessed, because not just her eyes falling, she has called out your name and she's shown to you continuously, like how you are sharing from beginning of your life, Ma. Like, she has been there for you, continuously protecting you. Then the divine intervention happened. Now your whole life has transformed in a phenomenal way. And here you are ready to manifest that consciousness, the super consciousness through you. And Devi Parashakti is showing you that she is there continuously with you.
And actually, it was
May I share one more thing? When you said that she has been with me throughout my entire life, that actually brought something up that I thought was really, really exciting and very special. And I try to share this as often as I can. So when I was younger, I lived in a very tight-knit community. I grew up in the state of Kentucky in the United States. And I was walking home from church. I decided to walk from church to my grandmother's house. And it's not a big walk. It's not a long walk. It's not a scary walk or anything like that. But that day, something in me told me not to walk home. And I decided to do it anyway. And then as I was walking, this fear just really rose in me, and I didn't know what to do. I just kept walking, and I saw these group of guys, and they felt very scary. All of a sudden, out of nowhere, I kid you not, my mother is my witness. She can verify this, and so can my grandmother. There, this big, white, ferocious dog walks up to me. And at that time, we used to have a lot of stray dogs running around, but I never seen anything like this. I'm a very short person. And so this dog kind of came up to like about here to me, and it looked up at me, and then it just kept walking with me. And so I'm walking very, very straight, kind of scary. And then this group of guys, at first they started whooping and hollering at me. And then they saw the dog. They said, "Is that your dog?" I said, "No." He said, "That is a scary looking dog." I said, "I know." And I just kept walking. I walked all the way to my grandmother's house. When I got to the driveway, and the way her driveway works, you walk up the driveway, and then there's a walkway that takes you up this path up to her porch, and you go in the house. The dog at first stopped at the street, then walked to the driveway with me. And I thought, "Oh no, what am I gonna do? How am I gonna get in the house?" It stopped right at the pathway. It waited until I walked inside and started walking away. And so when I walked inside, I ran up the stairs and I ran to the window to look. I watched the dog walk. And my grandmother lived on a corner. It went to turn the corner, and there was this big bush. So you should see it walk past the bush. It walked by the bush, and then you didn't see it walk past the bush. It just disappeared. Wow. I never saw that dog again. So then I took Padma Shibboham level 2. Swamiji told me to take it a few months ago. So I just took it again a few months ago. And we got to ask Lord Kalibirbo one question. Well, since then, I come to know that his dog, his vehicle is a dog, and he is my Ishtadevata. I love him. Aww. If you see my altar, I've got him everywhere. And so I asked him, "Was that you that was protecting me?" And he said, "That was a form of me protecting you."
Wow.
I was 15 at that time. I didn't find Swamiji until I was 37. And so even back then, he was protecting me. And that just,
wow.
That was just...
Seema. Swami says, "See, the divine intervention is continuously happening in our lives. The moment we click with it, then that we experience it. He is there from beginning. He has been there, continuing to be there in many people, even the new viewers that are watching live right now. You might never know. You might have come across so many times when divine has been protecting you. And very soon, when you realize and that divine intervention happens in your life, when you come face to face with the avatar, then you realize how he has been there throughout your life, protecting you, taking care of you, and just waiting for you to get connected so that you can experience that super conscious breakthrough in you. Thank you so much, Ma.
Such a beautiful sharing, Ma. Just one last thing that is there. Like, how from being a typical New Yorker, a typical American, and a proper Western upbringing, to now being a Hindu with complete sari, kumkum, jata, srinetra tilak, rudraksha, everything. How would you like to sum it all up?
It's such a more blissful life. It's a more rewarding existence. I understand things about life now that I didn't before. There's a compassion that I have, not just for my fellow man, but for my fellow beings. One of the recent satsangs that Swamiji had, he was talking about just how every creature's life is important. Even a fly's life is more important than money. When he said that, that really, really clicked with me. Just how we have to really be mindful of everyone's life, everyone's existence. It's so important not to eat meat. It's so important to try not to use leather. It's important to just be very conscious of what is happening in the world around us, because that heals. When people see that we are gentle and that we are kind and that we care about the animals, the creatures around us, what we put in our body, and then it shows and people say, what is different about you? How can I look like you? Because I look younger now than I did 10 years ago, you know, that, and I tell them, then that makes them want to try it more. And there's so many people around me now that don't eat as much meat as they did before, or they don't eat meat now because they want that. And that's a great way to just kind of get in and show them more. I feel like there's a conscious awakening happening to people slowly, and they want to know more about how to just better themselves and their lives. And truly, Hinduism has done that for me. It's better. It's made me a better person. It's made me a kinder person. It's made me not a happier person. It's made me a more blissful person. And I think that's the difference.
Thank you so much. It was really a beautiful and touching sharing.
It was a fun sharing. So many people are commenting, and there's so many people right now watching us on YouTube who have commented that they really enjoyed your sharing. They really connected with your sharing. So thank you so much. Thank you so much for taking your time and being here. And of course, all of our gratitude to Swamiji for always being there with us and giving us these profound experiences. Thank you, Ma. Yananda.